Stories Podcast, your number one show for everything guitar.
Hello, Dan.
Hello.
Hello, YouTube. Hello, everybody in the live chat.
Hello, everyone listening on the podcatchers, and welcome to the Guitar Stories Podcast. Today, with a slight delay. Sorry.
So, if you're listening on the audio and you haven't been watching the chat in the YouTube, Dan is now streaming on rig number three, rig C.
Yeah. That is great.
Plan A, plan B went somewhere, and now you're on rig C.
That is correct, yeah. But it's still working, right?
It's working. We can see you. Yeah. Yes. So, everybody, this is Dan. I've been with you for about 15, 30 minutes. You know, Dan's just been sitting around eating pizza. And no, something went wrong with Dan's camera. We fixed it. It doesn't matter. Nobody noticed. We're just going to smooth over this as if it didn't happen. Absolutely. Hi. Hi, Dan. How are you?
Good. Excellent. What about you? Did you have a good week?
Till about 20 minutes ago, yeah. Yeah, it was really good.
I ruined everything.
No, I had a great week. I had a really good week. Yeah, it's been brilliant. I've had a really good time. Thanks for asking. How about you? I hear you're having some ill people in your workplace.
Yeah, but nothing too severe at the moment. So we're just waiting and see and hope for the best. At the moment, it's just a crazy situation. And yeah, luckily, we're not having any issues so far. But yeah. You know, sometimes stuff happens, so we got to cope with that.
And, crazy situation. Yeah. Which Queen song is Absolutely. That from? Someone let me know. Trying to do my best. It's a hard life. Thank you very much. Dan's already put several songs in my head whilst we were doing this. If you, I will just talk about what's just happened just momentarily because I was covering it in the chat, you know, just sort of bantering. Dan was trying to plug in batteries and charge things, then trying to get a computer working. Now he's on his phone. And it was very, very amusing for me hearing you talking to your devices in a calm manner.
Did I do it in a calm manner? I was a little bit like...
It was calm, but it was... For those of you, you know, for regular listeners, you'll know Dan is one of the nicest people. And... he didn't get angry at all. I think I would have probably got a little bit angry there. I was very impressed, but it was very, very funny.
I was just disappointed because those cameras, they are quite expensive. And, you know, it's quite a letdown if the battery didn't last a week because I didn't recharge it from last week, but I didn't like use any of the battery because I was actually using the plug. So,
yeah. I mean, those sound like excuses. I don't want to, you know. I thought you were better than that.
I know.
Right, well, we've got lots of people in the chat already, and I'm sure lots of people are listening to the audio. We have got an amazing show. I know I say this a lot, that I can't wait to talk to the guest, and I love this guest, but the guest we have tonight is actually one of my favorite people whom I've never met, but just purely based on her content alone, I am so excited, and if it was a worse guest, I would be in a less good mood, but I'm in a fantastic mood. I hope you are, Dan.
Yeah.
Agreed. I know you're excited as well to talk to Rachel, and she's in Skype already in the green room waiting, and she's probably watching the chat as well, so get your questions ready. We're going to bring you some news and also some picks of the week, maybe half a pick each this week, because we're going to try and get Rachel on as soon as possible. So let's pop to the news. News is this week, that's a Kirk Hammett guitar, Dan. That is the one that he used in a... Can you guess which music video, or do you know this piece of news? Have you,
I think
you had any
that
Dan
should
time?
Be, yeah, I had some Dan time. I think that should be the one video.
Correct.
Yeah.
It's just sold.
For how much?
Take a guess. Does anyone know in the live chat? Take a guess, Dan. So,
I don't know, like 6K? 8K?
Six figures.
What? Six figures? Wow.
No, it's set to. It's reached 26,000 already.
So it has been sold already, or are they still bidding on it?
Oh, that the bidding thing changed. Okay. It sold for 112,500. There we go.
Holy moly.
So what's that? That's a quarter of a mil. No, hang on. An eighth of a mil between friends, isn't it?
Between friends, yeah. I mean, it's got some value to it, of course, but wow, that's a lot of money.
Yeah. There's another picture of it there, which is not very useful. It just looks like one of those strats that you put together out of a kit, in my opinion.
Frankenstrat.
Yeah, but yeah.
Yeah, I mean, then you can say you own the guitar that's in one video. I mean,
it is a good song.
That's something.
A classic video. But yeah, so there's that. But I don't know much about it. So that's what we got. I was hoping Dan was going to fill me in, but Dan's veins are still popping out of his forehead. So I'm waiting for Dan to calm down a little bit.
No,
Dan, I want to show you the most disgusting thing I've seen in a while. Can I do that?
Absolutely.
This is a guitar, one of those sort of filled guitars that I was ranting about last week. So last week I was ranting about people filling guitars and like these, what's it called? I can't remember the word. I am blanking. But epoxy resin. Resin guitars,
resin,
sorry.
Yeah, resin, yeah.
Now I'm the one flipping around. So I was sent this, and if you're on the audio podcast, apologies. It is a guitar. Sorry, it's a bass guitar filled with cigarettes. So imagine a clear guitar filled with used cigarette butts.
I mean, as if it would not be like bad enough that it's a bass guitar, but a bass guitar filled with cigarette leftovers. It's just there.
It is a boomy chap. Yeah, I really, it makes me want a wretch. So if you're listening to the audio version, check out the video so you can see this, because it's disgusting.
It looks disgusting. I wonder if it smells disgusting too.
That's my biggest worry. Like, it must stink.
Mm-hmm.
But,
Just looking at that image gives me so much pain inside.
Good. Good, oh. You should. That means you're a well-adjusted person.
Oh.
And then I guess further news, Dan, is that we have a Discord server now.
There you go. And we already shared some nice memes and guitar videos and stuff like that. So please come and join. What's the address, sir?
I guess the second piece of news, the sub news, is that I don't know how to use Discord. so I'm learning while I'm doing, but it's the Guitar Geek Discord, and then there's a sub channel in there, I guess, a sub chord, a diminished chord that is dedicated to the Guitarsaurus podcast. You can send us your images if you want your guitars to be in the intro to the podcast. You can send us funny stuff that we can talk about, or you can just say hi, etc. So I've just seen Valeria forgot to join. Come on, get your act together, Valeria. But also, Michiel has sent us a super chat, and it says "F you, Dan." So I don't know what that stands for. It's impossible to possibly decode that, but I'm guessing it was the comment about the bass.
I think so. Yeah.
So I have no idea how to do the Discord, but if you have Discord and you search for the Guitar Geek and you see something that looks like the label, the logo of the channel. It's open at the moment. I don't know if it should be open. and there's also a secret area for Patreon people as well, just so you know, hint, hint. But yeah.
I think I know what he meant. I think he wanted to say, funny you.
Ah, you funny you.
Yeah.
He's so nice, that chap. He's so nice. Let's go on to my pick. Andy's pick of the week. Andy's pick of the week, first up, is this. It's my own video. it's not my video. It's the Hofner Shorty that I modified for Michiel, strangely enough. And he said that if I chose this pick of the week, he would super chat us the postage that it cost me to send it to him. So put your money where your mouth is. You've just super chatted us €2. We want another $30 on the table. I didn't actually intend to put that first, but you know, it did happen. That is my first pick of the week. I'm quite proud of that logo as well, and very proud of the hair in that picture. So,
yeah,
yeah,
the geek tweaks.
Yeah, I guess I'm just waiting to see if Studio Camille has caught up. So I'm now, I think that's enough airtime for that. Moving on, this Telecaster is something that we missed in January.
Uh-huh.
And it's an artist's signature Telecaster. And I don't know how to pronounce his surname, but it's Jason either Isbell or Ibell. He's a country player. And this this guitar is it's a chocolate Telecaster. So it's nitro. It's a nitro finish. It's a standard tele setup, 3-barrel tele pickups, 3-way switch, rosewood fretboard, black pick guard, 6 strings. And it just, it's slightly relics as well. It's based on his guitar.
Okay.
And I just think it's absolutely stunning. On the surface, it's a tele. That's it.
Is that US made?
No, it's Mexican made, which means it's only priced, I say only, it's priced at about 1,300 euros.
All right, fair enough.
Meaning that I think that's achievable because we've got a few other guitars that have been released this week we're not talking about, such as the Joe Bonamassa thing, and that's 8,500 euros or dollars. And there's also the Strat that came out that was something like 15. And I'm sure they're great guitars, but they're automatically out of range for most of us. And that one, which looks stunning and a nitro finish, meaning it's going to relic beautifully, is, I think, certainly not cheap, but obtainable if you really, really want it.
Mm-hmm. Oh, well, it looks pretty classy. I like that kind of... What's the finish? It's not a regular sunburst. It's more like a honey burst-ish.
It's like a... He called it like a chocolate finish.
Chocolate, and, okay.
I would have more information, but I was busy doing tech support tonight.
first and second level.
Yeah, just another slight dig there. Maybe I'll get some more in, but there's another picture there, another close-up. I just think it's absolutely gorgeous. Not sure about the relicking. Not sure.
Yeah.
But I'm hoping...
Sometimes the kind of in the cheaper levels, the relicking can look a little bit like... unprofessional.
Yeah, but I think that because it's nitro, as you play that, if you look on the up about, that's gonna relic even more as you play it. So I see that as they've started it off for you.
Yeah, I mean the good question is, how does Mexican chocolate taste? Does that make sense? No.
Spicy.
Chili. Chili chocolate.
Hmm.
Ooh, that would make for chocolate. Great.
That would go down very well right now.
Yeah.
Okay. And there's the back of it as well. I don't like the fact that you can see the pieces of wood. If I'm honest, I think in that picture, I nicked that especially from the Sweetwater website. Yeah. But
since they are asymmetrical, right? It's like 2/3 and one, like the upper part is 1/3, and then the lower bout is 2/3, and that would drive me nuts. I'm a little bit monk-esque in that regard.
It does have a mid-60s or early 60s neck, meaning it's a little bit thicker but it's a slightly thick neck, which, of course, does it for me. So put that into your buy, borrow, or burn, and we'll move on to my next pick, which is this, the Harley Benton Airborne Go Amp. And there's a very special reason I'm choosing this, and that is because I'm currently using, as my main amp in my living room, the Nuex Mini one, which this one is somehow related to. And I have played through this tiny little amp, not the Harley Benton, but the Nuex one, so much. It's got a built-in drum machine. It's about 140 euros. It's got several channels for, you know, clean overdrive distortion. It's got an aux in. It's got Bluetooth. It's got a headphone out. It's got wireless. And I just think it's an extremely convenient, well-priced amplifier. And of course, being Harley Benton, it's going to be selling very, very well. And I haven't played it yet, but I will at some point. I'll get a review done. And I think that's a really good potential buy.
I mean, it looks sounds as if you've got a lot of bang for the buck. Is there any alternative for that? Are there other comparable amps or options?
Well, there's I believe that looks bigger than the Nuex one that I have, even though this is a Nuex amp branded Harley Benton. And it actually says powered by Nuex on the back.
Oh, wow. Okay.
If you're wondering who Nuex is, you might know them as Nux, if you're listening, because people say Nux. If it's anything like the amp I have, this Harley Benton is cheaper. So this, I mean, it sounds, the sound is not great. It's a tiny little amp. It's not going to be a full-size 12-inch speaker combo amp. However, mm-hmm. all of the stuff that you need for practicing, I've been having a great time. And it's, as you know, my main rule for gear is that if it makes me want to play, if it makes me have fun, then it must be good. And so therefore, 140-ish euros? Yeah.
Is that available already?
Yes, it is.
Oh, wow. Okay. Well, guys?
I'm 86% sure that it's available already.
Awesome. So, I mean, in any case, if someone would want to pick that up, they surely would use one of your affiliate links that they can find on your channel.
Of course, absolutely. But maybe wait for my review so I get, like, you know, thousands of views on that. But that's not the reason I'm choosing it. I genuinely think, as a guitarist to another bunch of guitarists, that looks like a good buy. Speaking of goodbye, goodbye. Dance, pick up the wink. Dance,
pick up the wink. Andy is the king of the transitions today.
Yeah, I got the button.
Oh, yeah. There you go. My picks. So this is like honorable mention because I didn't actually select the ROG pedal as my first pick. But I just like the idea that's designed in conjunction with KHDK and Ryan Posing. And who's the other guy? Help me.
From that band.
Yeah. Is it Fall Out Boy? No.
Yes.
Fall Out Boy, yeah.
Yes. Oh. So we are not switched on tonight, people. We're going to let you down. We need Rachel in this chat ASAP to actually pick up the energy levels.
Yeah. I mean, it's just like honorable mention.
Because
Henning did an amazing video on that. I think it's one of the most hilarious videos he's ever done. So if you get a chance, check that out on his channel. It's hilarious. Like, the density of penis jokes is incredibly high.
Yeah.
I highly recommend watching that.
I would steer away from this pedal. It I don't find it funny, and I know that makes me a grumpy old man, but it does sound great. And I do have the other KDK. I don't. I never pronounce the company name. I have the Steel Panther pedals. There's something. Right. I don't know. Maybe I'm challenged by this.
Yeah. You know what KHDK stands for?
No.
No. It's the initials. It's Kirk Hammett and David Karen. The two founders.
Of course. That guy that was with the wah pedals.
Yeah, that kind of up and coming dude.
Yeah, he sold a guitar recently. Yeah. All right, that was the honorable mention. I've got to throw you through because Rachel's waiting to get in the chat and I need to get off this energy low. What is that, Dan?
That is a new Jackson guitar. It's Misha Mansour's latest models. Misha Mansour signature, and these now come with Evertunes. And I found it interesting, so I chose it as my pick of the week because more and more guitars are kind of equipped with Evertunes. And the Juggernaut ET6 and ET7 comes with pretty interesting specs, like caramelized fingerboards and kind of Porsche or car-inspired colors. It's basically what you would get from a regular Misha Mansour signature model in that price range. I think it's around $1,300, but I found the point remarkable that it comes with an Evertune bridge, and I actually wanted to bring that up and ask our guys in the chat and also you, have you had any experience with that? Are you kind of eyeing on getting a guitar with an Evertune bridge, or is that just like a trend, so to say, and might be over before it has begun?
I've only ever played one guitar with an Evertune bridge, and it was for seconds, quite literally under a minute. Okay. I was definitely not enough time to answer your question. It kind of skips me by, and working with the guitars that I work with, they don't generally have Evertune bridges on them. Mm-hmm. However, I remember there being a lot of dislike for it, and I couldn't figure out why. If it does what it says it does, then surely that's good. So I am thoroughly underqualified to answer that question. Maybe some people in the chat or somebody out there in the world can put us right. But I, as far as I'm concerned, I'd love to try one. I wouldn't buy one with it on, having never tried one. Put it that way.
All right, I hear. Okay, that might be an indicator already in which category that guitar might land.
I will not buy it. May I move you on to your next suggestion, sir?
Absolutely.
Here we have your second.
Yeah, and this is kind of brand new. So just in, like literally minutes before we started show, Emperor released the Power Cabinet. And that's basically an addition to their portfolio because they already had a cabinet, very lightweight. I have one at home. It's pretty decent. And you've got several imprints. So you have a choice of, I think, 19 different like speaker characters that you can choose from. And with the Power Cabinet, it is now also an option for everyone who owns a profiler stage or any of those unpowered profiler models. I think that's a pretty smart move to add that to the portfolio. I really like that. And I think it's priced around $680, depending where you live.
Yes,
correct. So I find it quite reasonably priced. And I think it's just a stroke of genius that they added that to their portfolio. And I think a lot of people will try that. My personal perception so far is it's a very, very well-made cabinet. It's at least the one that I got, the unpowered one, is rather lightweight. So
And in yours, is there a regular speaker? It's just a cab. Standard.
It's just a cab without the power section. Okay. Correct. Because I've got you can see it in the back. Where is it? There. I've already got one that's powered.
Oh, yeah.
And I like it. And I thought that's really great news because it provides a lot of people that own a profiler without the power section another option.
I think it's €689, which is what I'm looking at, and $789 and 500 British pounds. That's a worthwhile investment. Dan, you're not going to believe this. It comes with a dust cover, a foldable speaker stand for angling the speaker, and a power cord.
Wow.
I know.
It comes with that's more than your Sony cameras come with.
I dropped the subject. I dropped it. As far as I was concerned, it was over. It was in the past, like Rafiki from The Lion King. But you had to go there.
Yeah.
All right.
I wonder where do you get those analogies from?
I don't know.
Those analogies are great.
Thanks very much. I'm working on it. It's time to see which ones we like, which ones we don't, in Beg, Borrow, or Burn.
Buy, borrow, or burn.
I mean, buy, borrow, or burn. Sorry.
private question before we proceed. Did you you got kids? Did you ever when one of your kids was a baby, did you ever have the urge to kind of lift it up like in The Lion King?
Dude, it was a daily occurrence.
Yeah, same here.
and then I just get looks from my girlfriend and their mom, like, what are you doing? And she didn't even get the reference. You know, I think it's a dad thing.
You know what? The people, they are kind of looking at you and giving you that look when you do that. I was like, you know, what's the problem? I'm standing here with, you know, in the pedestrian area and I'm just lifting up my girl singing, why?
Ooh. No. Yeah. Don't. That's like the fourth song you put in my head. Great. Now I'm going to be talking to Rachel.
I never promised you,
Rachel, about Hakuna Matata. I wonder if Rachel likes Lion King. She's watching, so she can let us know when she joins. Buy, borrow, or burn. We've had six products. Yep. We said we'd do four. We've done six. we've had the telly from me. We've had the Harley Benton amp from me, and we've had the modified Hofner Shorty. What have we had from you, sir?
We had the Kemper. Hmm? We had the Misha Mensu Evertune Juggernaut, and we had the Rock KHDK pedal.
Okay, so things are coming in the chat already. Studio Camille bought that Hofner, but he'd rather own Kirk's guitar, burn the Kemper stuff, and borrow that chocolate. Okay.
But only if that chocolate's not from the 60s.
Fergie will buy the telly because he doesn't have a telly. You don't have a telly? Borrow the camper cab, burn the neck of the Jackson just enough to darken it. Fair enough, fair enough. L&M Guitar Corner will buy the Fender, borrow the Jackson and burn the camper because he doesn't have a camper amp. Okay, but you could still use the cab for other things, but I understand you've got to choose something to burn. And Christopher just noticed that I'm wearing the same sweater I was wearing the other day. Yes, I am. I was doing some grungy stuff today, so I decided to wear my grungy sweater. So I would buy the telly. I would borrow the Kemper. And I would burn the Hofner Shorty because it absolutely kicked my butt. And I don't care if Mikhail does a super chat of any more money or in case if he takes his super chat back. That Hofner was an absolute pain in the bottom. And I'm glad it's gone. Although it did sound quite good.
All right.
Danielson.
Yeah. That's really tough tonight. But I gotta say, I probably also burn the Hofner, but it probably wouldn't burn too long because it's rather short. I'll definitely borrow the rock pedal from Henning, and I might it's a tough one. Buy the Kemper cab, just assuming that I would not already have the unpowered one.
Okay.
Yeah, that was fairly
It's getting
easy.
To the point now where I want to guess that your choice is, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
That's exactly what I mean. Next week. Of cheating. Yes.
Next week.
I'll try and guess yours.
We guess the others. Yeah. We take notes. Yeah.
But Mikhail did drop us the $15 in the super chat. Thank you, Mikhail. And you know I love
He's
you.
He's a man of honor.
He is. But I really thought that he was only going to drop it if I said that I'd buy it. I mean, I've borrowed it already for about a year. So I couldn't choose that one. Dan, I've had a wonderful time going through the gear tonight. It's kind of nice having this slightly stressful trying to catch up on time thing.
Well, I could have elaborated a little bit more on one or the other piece. But anyways, we're waiting for Rachel. And I think
we are
in the chat.
So
too.
What I'm going to do is I'm going to call Rachel, and I haven't figured out the tech stuff of this yet because it should just work straight away. But you know us.
Okay.
You know, that was until we had CameraGate.
So
that should work. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to call Rachel, and then when Rachel joins us, she won't be live just yet. I'll have to do some jiggery pokery and see what happens. I'm very excited. Hi, Rachel. Can you hear me, Rachel? Okay, she can't hear me. That's a shame. One second. Can you hear me? You can?
Yeah.
Wonderful. Then let me just change my camera because I need you to be able to see Dan as well and the lovely people in the chat. There we go. So now you should be able to see the chat screen we were just on. And now I will add you to the podcast. So here's our guest thing. And then I do that and set up the old thing like this. There you are, and you should be.
Awesome. Can everyone hear me?
I believe they might be able to. Dan, can you hear Rachel?
I think only through your video, your audio, but not.
Oh, now I can't hear Dan. Rehearsing. Oh, this is wonderful. one second. It's great that you're here. Thank you for your patience, Rachel.
Yeah, of course.
We've been singing your praises, and we're very excited to talk to you.
Yeah. Thank you so much for having me on.
I'm fanboying out, if I'm honest. Dan, I don't hear you, mate.
What's wrong? I didn't change anything.
No. So, okay, the chat can hear you. The people live can hear you, but they cannot currently see you.
It looks like I'm behind Dan.
Oh, yeah, you are behind Dan. There you are. Right, hang on. I don't know if you caught up. We had some technical issues tonight. We normally we're smooth as butter, but tonight we had a few issues.
Yeah, the streaming stuff always has some issues.
Yeah, do you stream ever?
I've only done it like 2 times so far, so this is kind of new for me too. But yeah, it just seems like there's too much to get set up.
Yeah, it's a lot. All right, I found you. You've accidentally come in on Dan's Skype. There you are. And now I can put you there and drag you under there. And there you are. But now we can't hear Dan for some reason. And I don't know why. Yeah. Can I just check with the people of the chat? Can you hear Dan?
Can you hear me, guys?
I'm just checking the chat, Rachel. The people now telling me in the chat they could see Rachel behind Dan. Yeah, I'm blind. So it's about a 30-second latency. And yeah. So you can all hear Dan, but I can't hear Dan. That's wonderful. And Rachel, you can also not hear Dan, I guess.
No, I can actually hear Dan. So
what?
All right. Awesome, but I cannot hear Rachel.
Oh. Hashtag free Rachel. Okay, we will get this stuff sorted in a minute. Dan's OBS Ninja, monitor and output.
Yep.
I have no idea why I can't hear Dan, and you can. This is odd.
But Dan can't hear me.
I think they can. We can.
I'm gonna call Dan on WhatsApp here, just because this is how we roll on the Guitar Stories podcast. Dan, I can't call you on WhatsApp because you're using your phone as a webcam.
I'm using my phone.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah. You can't call me.
Well, if you've got some questions for Rachel, you can ask her in the chat because Rachel can probably see the chat right now. Am I right?
Yeah,
Rachel?
I can.
I have Rachel, no idea why I can't hear you, Dan. We even tested this earlier.
Yeah. Do you want to reconnect and just like switch Rachel and me off and just call us again? Would that make sense? Probably not, right? No? Well.
So the people in the chat can hear Dan. I think the only quickest way possible forward is to also call Dan on Skype and add him to this conversation.
All right.
And then we'll all be able to hear each other and the chat will be able to hear us. Is that okay with you, Rachel?
Sounds good to me.
Okay, here we go. I'm adding Dan to the Skype. We're going to have two Dans for a moment. Dan, is that okay? Is that going to work? We don't know. You can exit your OBS Ninja, Dan.
Okay.
And there we go. You're getting extra points for having an RG behind you, apparently.
Yeah, I put it there for this.
Oh, really? Sneaky.
All right, now I got you on the cell phone.
Oh, now I can hear you. I cannot currently see you, but I will fix that in a second.
I can see you.
I'm sure the people watching this will have a wonderful time. Dan, too.
Yeah, Andy, I have you on the cell phone. Do you want to call me on the computer instead?
Oh. Well, yeah.
Yeah, please.
Okay, then you hang up, Dan. I'm so happy you're one of the jolly people, Rachel. Other people would not put up with this absolute rubbish.
I think this is totally normal.
Is it? It's even worse than we normally are. And I've got
all right. Ah! Okay,
Dan is
there I am. Yeah, yeah. You should not be able to see me because of some weird issues, but at least you should be able to hear me.
There we go.
Is that right?
And then. Hello?
Yep. Check one, two. I've got echo now. People are telling me.
Yeah, we've got echo because we've got two Dans. Chill out, everybody. The Guitar Stories podcast. I've quite literally
we can edit
got
that in post.
10 fingers.
Yeah, we can edit that in post. No problem.
Yeah, we can just have to say everything twice. So let's do... I can't see your video at all, Dan.
I mean, that's no issue. Then just put Rachel there and everything's all right.
Okay. Well, Rachel, you briefly saw Dan.
Yeah.
That was Dan.
Nice to meet you both.
Thank you. We're here. We can all hear you. Everything's wonderful. Rachel, I'll say it again. It is a pleasure to have you on the chat, and you are one of my heroes. And when I have an even slightly less than wonderful day, I watch your videos because they bring me so much joy. And thank you, thank you, thank you for being here right now live. It's amazing.
I really appreciate that. That's so cool to hear. It's, yeah, I really appreciate it. Thank you.
You're welcome. Dan?
Yeah.
I thought you might want to say something nice as well, you know, make up.
Yeah, of course. I mean, I was looking forward to tonight because I've been chatting with Andy back and forth about your channel, and we're both like in unison, so big fans of your enthusiasm and how contagious you are when it comes to guitar playing. I mean, it's just whenever I'm kind of not feeling it, I can watch one or two videos and then I just want to play the guitar. Yeah, and in fact, I actually tuned down a whole step and played Square Hammer this weekend again.
Oh, nice. Yeah, I'm a huge Ghost fan. I have some Ghost albums behind me there.
Yeah, lovely. Actually, I own a transparent vinyl with Square Hammer and a couple other songs. My bigger daughter, she loves that too. She always, when she was like smaller, she was carrying that transparent vinyl around, always wanted to give it a listen.
And that's awesome.
Jumping around and yeah. So, yeah.
Yeah, so I guess if people are listening or watching and have not heard of, for some reason, or not met Rachel before, then you can probably tell that Dan and I are both very, very enthused. And you need to know who Rachel is. I'm sure I'm giving you an announcement you don't need. But we also talk a lot about mental health on this podcast and musician mental health and how important it is to take care of yourself. And again, I'll reiterate that you give me joy, and it's so cool to watch your videos and how real they are. And I have to draw attention to one thing you did, which was the jammy video quite a while ago now, I think. And I loved it because you were just so honest and real and fun. And I don't know. I'm just blurting out compliments because it was so enjoyable. I don't even know what to ask you. I'm just happy to sit here and watch
maybe,
you smile.
Maybe, Andy, since a lot of people, or not a lot of people, since some people might not be like aware of our channel or not like a regular audience, Rachel, could you just give us a very quick rundown of your personal guitar story? Because I think there's... you're one of the few like kind of people in the internet that kind of documented quite well their progress when it comes to playing the guitar, and also kind of got famous because those videos are usually the ones that kind of are very well received and people can relate to that, you know, seeing yourself, you know, struggling with the first couple of chords and then kind of making some progress and, you know, learn the first song, learn a second song, and all of a sudden kind of rip the tightest riffs. Yeah, maybe just elaborate a little bit on where you started and where you're headed.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, so my channel is a little bit unique because I started, as you said, like recording videos really early on into my guitar playing. Like, so I didn't start my channel, I think, until about, you know, 7 or 8 months into my playing, I think. And I had been recording clips, though, prior to that, just for friends and family as I was learning guitar. And yeah, I kind of just decided to put it all together into a progress video. And that kind of really made my channel take off, that first year progress video I posted. It was kind of crazy at the time because, like, I had, like, you know, under 100 subscribers or something before that. And then one day that video just, like, took off a lot. And it was just really cool to see the response there. And then I've just been kind of making guitar-related videos ever since that. And yeah, it's been kind of interesting because I've been kind of growing with the internet and with the community. So I've had people watching me from like the very beginning as I've been learning the instrument, which has been really motivating, also a little scary at times, but overall really fun and cool way to learn, I think.
Yeah. But you didn't kind of start with the intention of like becoming that internet like or YouTube phenomenon, right?
No, yeah, I guess I was looking for a new hobby, and I first tried a couple different things at the time. This was like, it's 5 years ago now. Yeah. I tried like skateboarding for like like a week, and that didn't go very well. So then I was looking for something else, and you know, I had never really played an instrument before, but the little picture of Dan coming in. I never really played an instrument before, but I always liked music a lot, and really enjoyed listening to metal, and obviously guitars play a huge role in that. So I decided to just try it out, and yeah, I had no idea that it was going to like take me where it has, but mm-hmm. it's been really awesome.
Yeah, it is. I mean, you're now at 191,000 subs on YouTube, and like I said, there are so many like great comments. I think it's a very, very positive atmosphere, you know, in the commentary section. Of course, you've got a few trolls up, here and there, but apart from that, when I'm scrolling down, it's very, very positive, and you know, people, they kind of take motivation from what you do there, and yeah, they kind of spark their interest. Yeah.
Yeah, I think like the community on my channel is like, yeah, it's really great. There's so many positive people, and I think just kind of a lot of people are learning guitar. I think some people are more experienced, some people just want to start, and it's really cool that everyone can come together and be supportive of everyone else. Like, I just did a like riff video where I had a bunch of people in the community share their own guitar riffs, and it was really fun seeing everyone just going on everyone else's channels and commenting nice things. And yeah, I'm just really happy that I've been able to have such awesome people on the channel, and it seems like you have a really awesome community here as well.
Yeah,
there are a lot of parallels in what, or at least I try to parallel some of the stuff. Just positive attitude, good vibes. I love guitar. That's why I'm here. I love it, and I love the people that I've met through it. And that's what I believe the world needs. And it certainly seems to be what you're sharing. And there's enough negativity in this world. So what's wrong with a guitar? Even a bad guitar is still a great guitar. You know, even a guitar song played badly is still a guitar song. So I never saw anyone pick up a guitar and say, I'm not really having a good time with this, you know, and I'm going to continue playing, but I'm hating it. So I don't really understand why there is some negativity in the guitar world, but it doesn't really spread so much into other instruments. I think the guitar world is kind of special in that sense, which is saddening, but I don't really want to focus on the sad parts. I want to focus on the positive parts. I made an observation just before we went live, and that was that you kind of remind me of Paul Gilbert, who I'm a massive fan of. Just the way that you are, I don't know, the way you move your body and the way that you talk on camera. And I watched a Paul Gilbert video. I'm like, oh my goodness, they could be, you know, like cousins, or you know, let's say father and daughter or something, you know, to get the ages right. So yeah.
Yeah, I don't think that we're related, but I could see that a little bit.
I really hope you are. I really hope you go on those family shows and find out that Paul Gilbert's your third cousin's granddad's uncle. That'd be amazing. And that explains why you're so flipping good.
Well, thank you. Yeah, it's just like the YouTube channel, I think, has helped me a lot overall just with my practicing. And I mean, it's good motivation for me to have to post videos, and I really enjoy making videos. So I think it has helped me a lot, you know, grow as a guitar player and just in general, learn lots of things like learning how to record covers and things like that as well. So I've definitely learned a lot from being on YouTube.
Yeah, and Andy, if I might just add, I think I've checked her channel. I think there are like three main factors that kind of are responsible for her success. The first part is having a lot of fun playing the guitar. I think that's the starting point. The second one is kind of practicing on a regular basis and kind of, you know, do what you like and kind of play the songs that you like and also document that, because if you cannot kind of check what progress have I made, I think that's one of the mistakes that a lot of people do. They don't kind of document their progress, and you know, they kind of get that wrong impression that they are not making any progress because there's no A-B comparison to the day before or the week before. So sometimes you get that feeling that you're stuck in a rut or that you're not, you know, kind of improving. But, you know, your ears have already made some progress, so your playing kind of sounds bad to them, but it actually is even better than a couple of weeks ago. And of course, also a very important part is that Rachel plays Ibanez guitar.
Oh, there we go. There it is. I knew you were setting that up because you spent so long on number two.
I mean, I think it's true. I mean, I started out on the Esquire Strat, and while it was a good guitar, like when I got that first Ibanez guitar, I practiced way more, so that made me get better. So, you know, yeah. Give me the motivation.
Rachel, I don't know if you're aware, but Dan is the European brand manager. Is that correct, Dan?
No. Germany, Austria, and some Eastern.
Some of European brand managers Eastern, for Ibanez. Eastern so there's a lot of Ibanez content because Dan has 100 Ibanez tattoos. So
yeah. In my heart. Now I was setting that up just for fun, but it actually is a good point that once you kind of reach a certain level of seriousness in playing the guitar, I think a more professional, kind of more proper instrument can induce a lot of additional joy and kind of fun in playing it, you know. I'm not saying that it necessarily has to be an Ibanez guitar, but if you kind of make progress and you get a decent guitar, I think it adds a lot to the overall experience, right?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, when I think I got it when I was like 7 months into playing, which, you know, might be kind of early for some because it was like a pretty, you know, good quality guitar, pretty expensive for like a relatively new person. But for me, like, it was definitely worth it because I knew I was going to stick with it long term, and yeah, it just helped me a lot with my practicing and my motivation to want to practice. So I always like recommend people do invest in a nice instrument that they're excited about. If they like, it doesn't matter what skill level you're at, you can always play a nice guitar, you know.
I hear. But one question, really in regard of my like kind of professional side of things, when you were supposed to, or when you were at the point that you wanted to have a new guitar, how did you do that? Did you just check online, or did you go into the stores and kind of check different profiles? Because it's kind of hard as a beginner to define what's your preference and what do you really prefer. Do you prefer a super thin wizard neck, or are you more into like bigger kind of C-shaped baseball, semi-baseball bat necks, like on some vintage Les Pauls? How did you determine what you actually wanted in a guitar?
Yeah, that's a good question. So I kind of just... Honestly, I kind of went based on looks for this guitar. I didn't really know what I wanted. Like, I knew I wanted humbuckers in the guitar to be able to like handle more metal tones, but I didn't really know like much about guitars, and I didn't really want to go into a guitar store at the time because I was nervous. So I just ordered it online, and it ended up working out. But don't necessarily recommend that for everyone.
Super cool. I mean, Andy and I, we know that pretty well. We've been selected by our wives only by the looks, of course. But
you're on fire tonight, sir.
I know. There's no camera, so I can do whatever I want, basically. No, but like, frankly speaking, that's super brave. I mean, you could have completely like picked something that didn't work at all and didn't just kind of, you know, killed your enthusiasm about the guitar. That's interesting.
Yeah, so, I mean, like a lot of like bands I liked and stuff were playing Ibanez guitars, and I just really liked how they looked. So, you know, I figured it would work out, and I also could have returned it, I guess, if I really wanted to. But
that's true.
Yeah, it was a good decision for me.
Now, Rachel, I see a piano behind you. Do you also play piano?
Well, I have a piano. I got it like 3 months ago now. I haven't really played it that much yet, but I'd like to learn more, basically, and use it to learn more music theory stuff on it.
Yeah, that makes me really happy because I thought you were going to say, yeah, I've been playing piano for 10 years and, you know.
No, I can't. I have not gotten too far into the piano playing yet, but I will be trying.
It's a weird thing to switch. I also play a tiny bit of piano, and it's weird to switch between the two instruments because what I like about both instruments is that all the notes are available right there in front of you on the guitar and on piano, whereas on a horn or something, you have to do things. And with the piano, it totally changed my guitar playing. I got more chromatic, and I ended up getting out of things like the pentatonic box, which I immediately fell back into. But the piano is certainly an eye-opener, and I recommend anyone that plays guitar to also buy a piano or a keyboard instrument of some kind, just to open up some notes that maybe don't exist on your guitar yet. And was that the reason you bought it, or?
Yeah, that's pretty much what I was thinking too. Just like, it does seem like it's a lot more obvious than a guitar up front, like where the scales are, where the notes are, and things like that. And it just seems like a useful instrument to know how to play a little bit of, at least. So yeah, I don't know. And I also wanted to learn how to read music just for fun, but I haven't gotten too far in that yet.
There's no stopping you. Who reads music for fun? we have some sort of questions from the chat that I'm going to read out temporarily and frequently because we get loads of questions. Amanda says that she just followed you on Instagram this morning and you are awesome. And she says the camera string thing you did was cool AF. And I agree.
Oh, yeah, the wavy string thing. I was just kind of demonstrating you can use the rolling shutter effect from the way most cameras record to get really wavy, like spaghetti-like guitar strings. Yeah. And yeah, exactly, the waves. So that's a pretty cool effect.
I think this is one of the reasons I would recommend joining your Instagram, your content for anybody, because, and I mean this totally positively, you take these small things and you blow them up into this amazing, joyful experience. And a lot of people would sort of smooth over that, you know, they you know what I mean? Am I making sense? That's sort of, a lot of people focus on the big things, and there's a lot of times you focus on the small things and make them big, and that's beautiful. And that's really, really refreshing for me when I'm making content. I'm like, oh, damn, Rachel's done something really cool.
Well, thank you.
So more questions. We have one from, I believe, Michael, who has asked the question about three times and I've missed it. Michael Spark, can I ask Rachel if she has ever, if she had ever considered getting a 7-string before she won it, and what 7-string would it be? He's contemplating, oh no, it's an Ibanez, the RGD71ALPA Axion label, deep C4 fade flat or solar 2.7 TBR.
Classic Ibanez names. So I guess before I won that guitar, I guess that's another story in itself. So I won a 7-string guitar in an air guitar contest at Nita Strauss's album release party a couple of years ago, which was fun. I basically had supported her on her Kickstarter for the album and got to attend her release party, and then decided to do some embarrassing air guitaring, but walked away with a 7-string Ibanez. So that was worth it. I can pull it over once if you want to see
absolutely
that one.
Absolutely.
Yeah,
need
please
more Ibanez on this stream.
No, I just actually send you a picture for Michael. Of another beautiful 7-string.
So this is a seven-string from that was signed on the back here.
Wow. Oh,
we can't really see it, but this is, I don't actually know what the number on this, maybe Dan knows what this guitar is, but this is my 7-string that I have. And I haven't honestly played it that much. I've mostly been sticking to the 6-strings, but it's a really beautiful guitar.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
No. I was not aware that you won that competition, actually. That's amazing.
Yeah. It was kind of I did some pretending to throw a guitar in mm-hmm. an air guitar thing, like she kind of does on stage. But that was really fun.
Awesome. Yeah, just for the record, this that's an S, so it's a Saber line guitar, and it's a 1027, so it's a 7-string. In a beautiful cerulean blue burst finish. That's kind of that kind of translucent finish, and it's got a poplar burl and maple and panga panga neck through construction. Can you turn it around quickly?
Yeah, it has some really nice.
Oh, no, it's a bolt on, yeah, but it's like it's got the wings to it, so yeah.
Yeah, that has like the purple heartwood, I think, like on the back.
The neck is like that crazy, I think 11 or 13 piece. I think 11 piece panga panga and walnut and maple and purple heart. So they kind of use those kind of different layers to make it super, super sturdy, and so it doesn't twist.
It's a really beautiful guitar. So I was obviously super happy about getting this. And I think the question was if I had considered getting one before I got this guitar. And I had been considering it. I hadn't really started actually looking at guitars yet. I was kind of like, maybe I should get a 7-string one day. So I don't know if I have any like particular ones in mind I would have chosen instead of this, but you know, probably an Ibanez guitar based on my other guitars here.
How was really that cool transition for you from the 6-string to the 7-string?
Yeah, it's still something I have to get used to. Like I did like one cover with this and I've played on it a bit, but I haven't like focused too much on it yet. Definitely like a little bit less comfortable for me with like my hands like and wrist getting around the width of the neck, but yeah, it's not like too bad, but I think it would take a while to like get really good with it, obviously. But yeah, it's pretty fun to have around.
Super cool. I mean, it's a great guitar. I mean,
yeah. Good. Let me 1 second put it down.
So PAF 7 pickups from Demasio. That's like a pro level instrument. Yeah, great.
Yeah, Dan.
Well.
All right. Let's have another question, Rachel, if that's okay. King yep. Prawn. That's a great username. I don't know why I love that username. King Prawn. King Prawn. King Prawn. How do you... why is my inflection so weird? King Prawn. King... Anyway, that user asks, obviously you're loving the YouTube journey and that's cool, especially for us viewers, but do you have any aspirations to be in a band or do you have mates to jam with? Good question.
Another good question. Yeah, so I guess I haven't... So I don't really know that many people in person who actually like listen to like metal music or the type of music I listen to, and I don't really know that people who play instruments either. So like I haven't really considered joining like a band or anything like that. I'm pretty happy with what I'm doing on YouTube, and I feel like I have a lot of room to grow there and just learn a lot more with that. But I don't know, it could be fun someday, but it's not something I have like immediate plans for. But yeah, maybe someday.
I recommend you do. Playing music with other people is one of the greatest things I've ever done. I mean, I've got kids, so I've got to put that, you know, way up there. But the feeling that I get when I play, when you just lock in with another musician, when you've nothing really planned, and you're just playing. It doesn't matter what you're playing. You're just enjoying. Like, imagine if there was a bass, drums, and another guitar version of you. Imagine the smiles and the fun that would be in that room. That'd be like too much. And then imagine the videos you could release then. So I would really love to see that happen at some point. And I can't recommend it enough. And also, as a musician, to further yourself, to play with other people is just, it's one of the best things. You can really lean on other people and also elevate each other. I really do recommend it.
Yeah, I definitely hear that. Yeah, I'd like to someday. It'd be a little bit scary at first, I think, for me, because I've been mostly like, you know, a bedroom. Even though I've been playing on the internet, I've still been mostly just like in a room by myself playing. So it's definitely a whole different thing that I'm not used to. But I know it would be awesome to do someday.
Well, on the other side is that if you're playing live and no one's recording it, you can get away with anything. It doesn't matter what you do. Whereas YouTube is the opposite. You know, you've got to watch what you're doing. so yeah, I would recommend jamming, and I don't know how to go about these days. These days, I guess at the moment it's not really that possible. But there's some online stuff. Is it Kazam or Jam Kazam where you can jam online? Someone in the chat will correct me what it is, but you can. It's like Skype for musicians, where there's no latency and you can actually play with other people. That's also pretty fun. But my main question that I wanted to ask you today is, what do you do? Like, is music your job or do you have a job? And share with us as much as you wish or don't. But I want to know what you do.
Yeah, so right now this is not my like job. I have a full-time job outside of this in the software industry. But I'd love to spend more time on doing YouTube stuff in the future. And I'm not sure what exactly that means right now, but yeah, I do. So this is kind of like a side thing that I do mostly on nights and weekends right now. But yeah, I'd love to be able to spend more time on it in the future.
Cool. So I guess doing software, I don't know. Do the people that you work with, do they know about your YouTube channel? And because this is always very interesting for people who are sort of YouTube successful and then they have another life. Is it odd?
Yeah. Yeah, I think like most people do know about it. I kind of keep things like generally pretty separate. Like I don't really talk about stuff on my channel as much. I mostly just focus on guitar and music stuff. But like, yeah, the people in my daily life do know that I have a YouTube channel. And I think they think it's cool too. But yeah, it's fun.
Cool. We've got some software people in the chat right now. So they're probably feeling a deep connection with you. So thank you for making those feel happy as well. Dan, I, you're not here visually, so I'm not getting any visual cues from you. So if you've got anything you want to ask, I guess now would be a good time.
Yeah. Well, actually, that was also my agenda, asking if there was a point where you thought, well, maybe that could be something more than just a hobby. I mean, given that you still have a full-time job, you're still like kind of in both worlds. But like, is there any plan when you say you want to like kind of further that, kind of continue with that whole channel and kind of expand on that? Like, do you have any, what are ideas that you kind of have for the future development? Like, what do you want to do except for jamming with others once the whole Corona situation is under control?
Yeah, it's definitely something I've thought about, and yeah, it's obviously better if you can spend, you know, more of your time working on stuff. Like, it takes me a while to edit videos right now. I think I kind of post one like usually every 2 weeks or so, but I'd love to be able to do that more. I think it's like you know, important for keeping the community active and growing things to be posting pretty frequently. But yeah, I don't know. There's other things I'd like to do. Like, I've been kind of having fun, like, just trying to learn new instruments. And I think that it could be kind of a maybe fun series to, like, you know, try learning drums in a week or try learning something else in a week or something like that. So I think that could be something that could fit with the theme of my channel, but be a little bit different if I had more time there. And yeah, I've also started doing a series where I've been, like, learning new riffs in like an hour or two. So just kind of showing my progress learning in a short period of time. And I've been having fun making those as well. So I don't know. There's a lot of ideas, but I'm not totally sure exactly what direction I'm going in. But I'm excited to keep going on that and figure out what I'm doing.
Yeah. Are you on Twitch also available, or just on TikTok, Twitter, and Instagram?
Yeah, right now I don't have a Twitch, but I think that I would like to do more live streaming sometime. I always get a little bit nervous before a live stream, so I haven't been doing so many, but I think it is definitely really valuable right now. And I think a lot of people are, you know, who are big YouTubers have switched over to doing Twitch as well, because it's just such an awesome way to interact with the community. And
yeah
I don't know, it seems like a really good path forward.
Yeah, I think it would be super brave, for instance, to sit down there and start a Twitch session and just kind of approach like a song or just a riff and kind of just, you know, dissect that kind of nugget by nugget and just learn the parts and kind of, you know, show others how you kind of learn songs or learn parts of songs and kind of give them some tips also how to kind of internalize that. That would be
great.
Yeah,
I think that would be definitely a good thing. That's what I've been kind of doing in some videos, but it's different if you're seeing it live.
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah, that's what the point that Andy made. You can always edit any video until, you know, it's kind of perfect and you look like you're a god on the sixth and the seventh string. But it really comes down to kind of interaction with live people and kind of really occasionally fail. That's what we all do. I think that's much more brave than just like trying to make the impression that you're the perfect guitarist. I mean, nobody is, except for Steve Vai, maybe.
Yeah, Steve gets a pass.
Yeah.
Yeah, I
do you have any... Oh, sorry, no.
Okay, I wanted to say that a word that comes to mind when I see your videos is fearless, which I'm pretty sure you're not, but there's a bravery to what you do in your honesty and the fact that it is very authentic and real in the sense that it feels like you're just putting a camera there and then you're very naturally telling your story. Is that how it is for you, or is there like 100 takes of that one video, or do you just turn the camera on and be Rachel?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's, you know, kind of a mix depending on what I'm recording. I like want to come across that way. Like, I'm glad that it seems that way. And it's always a little bit unusual talking to a camera and getting used to that. I think, like, looking back at my old videos, I was a lot more awkward talking to the camera than I am now. And I think I could still be even more natural and, you know, do maybe less takes on saying something to make it seem more natural. It's something that definitely I think about, and I hope that I'm just coming across as authentic, because that's what I'm trying to do. But yeah, it's a mix of things. Like, obviously I do multiple takes when I'm recording, like not everything. Like, when I'm doing the learning videos, I don't do multiple takes there, but like if I'm recording a cover or something like that, do a bunch of takes to get a good one. But yeah, I don't know. It's always complicated, but I hope that I'm coming across that way.
At least in my experience, you absolutely are, which is, as a fellow content creator, both inspiring and frustrating. So thank you for that. I have a question. Well, it's from the chat, but it's also a question for me personally, that from Team Play is saying, why not live on YouTube? Why Twitch? And I'd like to also echo that question.
Yeah, that is a good point. I don't know. I did a few live streams on YouTube. I probably would do live streams on YouTube at first if I'm just doing them like randomly, like once in a while. That's probably what I do because I have the audience on YouTube. But I think a lot of people move to Twitch to just have a second face, you know, in case something goes wrong with YouTube, or it's good to have multiple places, multiple sources for your content. And yeah, I don't know. I would have to experiment with it. I haven't like decided if I would do Twitch or YouTube for sure, but I feel like a lot of people are making separate channels on Twitch, even though they have YouTube channels. So I don't know. What do you think about that yourself?
Well, Pooh Ninja, who is definitely more knowledgeable than I am on this subject, has just written in the chat, Twitch has a lower latency and is highly more profitable than YouTube.
Yeah.
Both of those appeal to me.
All right, that's it, folks. Next week on Twitch.
TV. For me, I I have a lot of managing my time, and because I'm this is my full time thing, manage my time to just do the YouTube, Instagram, Facebook group, the other things you do outside of working on YouTube, you know, in real life. The thought of opening up a Twitch and managing that, that scares me. And we just opened a Discord today, which I know nothing about. but people are having fun in there, and there's some happiness going on in there. So I think it's going in the right direction, and I can see the benefit of it. But for me, it's just the management side of it and starting something, knowing how much effort I put into this channel and how hard it is to do this. Starting something new seems scary, which is also good, of course, but I'd wonder if anybody would watch, you know?
Yeah, I definitely relate to that. Like, it seems like it could be tricky to get, you know, the audience from one platform to another. But yeah, I made a TikTok recently because I saw that was kind of, you know, blowing up, but I've only been posting like kind of randomly on it. It's hard to manage so many different platforms, but it's fun to try out the different types of content that each platform, you know, is made towards, geared towards.
Yeah, I also did TikTok, and I found myself spending more time watching other people just do stuff than actually using
it. Yeah, I've been doing that too.
That being said, I'm having an amazing time watching it. It's great. Not very productive, though. But
no, it's not.
I kind of like with Discord. Do you know Trey from Gear Gods? Or do you watch Gear Gods?
Yeah.
He started Twitch, I don't know how long ago now, but a considerable time. And he started doing live songwriting. So he was offering something different on Twitch that he wasn't offering on YouTube. And I think that's the key. If I was just to do gear demos and gear reviews and this on Twitch, it would make no sense. You know, hey, come over to Twitch now. But if you're offering something different, my issue is I don't know what else I could offer apart from hair care tips, maybe, or jumper choices.
Well,
Like maybe doing sometimes I'll play like video games once in a while. It could be fun to do like a Twitch video game stream or something like that. Just something totally different that I wouldn't put on my main channel normally. So yeah, I don't know.
See, you don't want to see my video gaming face. So <That's> just, mouth open, lip dragging the floor, you know, and swearing, which is totally off brand for me. Sorry, Dan, I spoke over you then.
Beep, beep. No worries. I was just thinking it would be cool if you do like live soldering stuff, kind of putting together a pedal or something, or even live unboxing and live first impressions kind of thing. If you had like a decent signal chain that you could just send the signal through and kind of get people first impression of what then is later to appear as a properly produced video on YouTube, I think that would be totally different content that would appeal to a lot of people, and also be something like a teaser for what's actually to come on the channel. Yeah, so I think there's something to Twitch that's more hands-on, more kind of sandbox-esque. And I mean, it's so niche. There's something for everyone. I think there are people building Lego sets live on Twitch. I mean, come on, give me a break.
Well, my issue with going live is that I have kids, and that door behind me can randomly open at any time, and it can be a kid covered in chocolate or anything, or indeed carrying some Lego. So, you know, and if Lego gets involved, then I have to stop whatever I'm doing because that's important.
But, I mean, that would just make it more interesting, right?
Yeah, exactly. It has happened a few times, and it is super funny. And I encourage my kids to come in here, but I don't know. I can't guarantee that one of them wouldn't come down and do something they shouldn't. but yeah, fears aside from that, I guess my main worry is not having anything to offer. This now feels like it's turned into a therapy session for me. Sorry. But Dan, all good suggestions. I will indeed consider that. I guess to be the YouTuber here is that if you want me to do that, let me know in the comment section or in the live chat or indeed on the new Discord. Do you have a Discord, Rachel?
I have like a Discord for just some Patreon supporters right now. I don't know. I've thought about making one for the channel, but I haven't really asked. I was kind of nervous that there'd be like too many messages to handle, but maybe someday.
Okay. That's exactly my fear again. Or not. I keep saying fear. I mean concern. It's time management. But
Yeah.
All right, I will open a Twitch just for you, Dan, and I will test some live unboxings and first impressions. And when I waste my time, I shall bill you for it. How's that?
Yeah. Awesome. Actually, I have one question to Rachel. Do you have any, or did you have, when you started playing the guitar, any role models, like guitarist or musician role models that you kind of try to either copy, or that kind of just, you know, sparked your interest in the guitar itself? Like, who was it at that time? Except for Ghost.
Ghost is actually a big one. But I feel like for me, it's mostly just like bands I like. I just really enjoyed, you know, I went to a lot of live concerts as well. I always enjoyed watching the guitar players playing live and just listening to guitar-based music. So, uh-huh. You know, my favorite bands like Nightwish and Ghost, and I don't know, there's probably a lot more. I like symphonic metal a lot, so a lot of bands like that. but I think it just like a combination of all of the music I listen to, and just trying to, I really wanted to learn some of the riffs and parts of songs from those bands. I also, of course, was really inspired by Nita Strauss. I think she's awesome too. And that's my second guitar I got was like a S-series Ibanez, or second Ibanez guitar I got was an S-series Ibanez. I think Nita used to play a purple version of it. I have like a blue S5470. But so she was a big inspiration as well, just watching her play with Alice Cooper. And yeah, I don't know. I have a lot of like different bands that have inspired me, but not like necessarily one particular person.
Mm, okay. Yeah, but bands can be like a big factor. I think that's the most fun, to just kind of, you know, practice songs and kind of put them on and play to it, and then, you know, kind of reduce the level and you know, go into the more delicate stuff. And at the end of the day, you are able to completely play a whole song. And I think that's much better than just chromatic 1-2-3-4, 1-2-3-4, or spider exercises and stuff like that. I mean, there's a time and place for everything, obviously, and for every practice routine. But especially as a beginner, I think if you just practice what you want and what kind of makes you happy, I think that's the most important part. And I think that's also why that's probably a point why you're so positive about everything, because you're actually having fun, you're not faking it.
Yeah, I think that's definitely been like, yeah, it's been a huge thing for me, as you said, just learning. I started pretty early on, just learning through learning riffs, even if I couldn't really play them very well. Yeah. Just kind of starting learning techniques through songs, and that's always made it a lot more fun for me. I mean, I think everyone, you know, struggles with periods where it's harder to get motivated, or something's not as fun because you're struggling. But like, I always come back to the music I really like, and that always inspires me to keep going.
How do you learn stuff? Do you learn it by ear? Do you check tabs? Do you like try to find the chords first? What's your approach? Because I mean, if you compare how people used to, you know, teach themselves or be taught the guitar like 20 years ago, it's completely different stories. It's a whole universe that opened up with YouTube and tabs and Guitar Pro and all that stuff. Like, how did you kind of learn songs like Square Hammer?
Yeah, so kind of depends on the song. I don't really use tabs pretty much at all. I just, for some reason, that doesn't really work for me. I don't think it's like bad, it just doesn't really work for me. I usually learn through a combination of like listening to the song and slowing it down. And also, if there are like video lessons on YouTube that other people have made, or just covers people have made, I kind of watch those and try to learn, you know, where their hands are. So kind of a combination of watching videos of either the artist or lessons or people playing, and also just listening to the song. So yeah, that's usually how I learn.
All right.
That's pretty much the same way I learned. Just song based. Left a lot of holes in my technique. I left a lot of mistakes. I hold the pick incorrectly, if you really want to say that. But I hold it the same way as Paul Gilbert. So, you know, that's all I always tell people when they tell you holding the pick. Yeah, I just love guitar, and it's so nice to be talking to some other people that are also loving guitar. And I know that's the reason the people in the chat are here, because they love guitar. And I think something that occurred to me about your joy of guitar, and I don't want to diminish that joy at all, that would be awful, but maybe it's because you have a career in software and that music is your hobby. Maybe that's the joy for you, because I know the guitar community, sorry, that's not fair. Some guitarists that have YouTube channels have opened YouTube channels after failing as a musician, you know? And I don't believe you ever fail as a musician. I believe you go through different parts of your journey. But I certainly would not have started as a YouTuber. I was a live player, much like yourself, came from the songs. I don't know where I'm going with this point, but I mainly wanted to say that if you did take this up more full time, do you think you could keep the joy alive if it became more of a responsibility?
Yeah, I think that's definitely something that, you know, a lot of people struggle with. And, you know, as I have been doing this more seriously, I mean, it has become, you know, partially, I mean, it's not a job, but, you know, it kind of becomes that way a little bit when you're worried about getting out videos and things like that. So I think it's just something that I always have to remind myself that, you know, I'm doing it for the fun of it. And like, I obviously have a lot of fun with it, but, you know, even I sometimes do feel that way and do feel distracted a little bit by, you know, thinking about it more as a job. But I don't know. I think I just, the love of guitar and the love of music can drive you forward through that. And, you know, sometimes taking a break for a little bit can help with that as well. So I'm just, yeah, I don't know if I have a great answer. I think that's a problem that probably everyone struggles with, but I'm hoping that it will work out.
No, I think you have answered the question. I'm not even sure there was a question. It was, but if there was, you definitely answered it. Dan, we are coming towards the end of the show. Have we missed anything with Rachel? I know it feels like we've been on for less than 10 minutes. I'm going to check the chat. Well, Dan, if you want to ask anything else for Rachel and Rachel has a little bit more time, that would be great.
Yeah, I'm fine.
Actually, gear-wise, you told us that your first guitar was a Squire?
Yes, yeah.
Yeah, and then you had that Ibanez or those two other Ibanez?
Yeah, the one back there.
Yeah. Do you have any other dream guitar that you wanted to own, either because it belonged to one of your heroes or you just, you know, kind of thought it's super cool? Any kind of future purchases or stuff that's on your wish list or pedals? I mean, that's a big passion of Andy.
Yeah. It's interesting because a lot of people have been asking me that recently because I think I haven't really gotten a guitar. I kind of bought my first two main guitars like a year into playing and then I haven't really personally purchased like many guitars since then. So yeah. It seems like it's overdue potentially to get another one sometime. But I don't know if I have like a particular one in mind right now. I've been interested in like trying out a Strandberg guitar because they look so different, you know, with like the fretboard and like the headlessness. I'm curious about them, but I haven't had a chance to try one out. There's like, I don't know. I'm sure there's always more Ibanez guitars that I'd like. And I don't know. I'm open to other guitars. So if anyone has suggestions for me of guitars I should check out, definitely let me know. I'm open to it. And as far as like pedals go, I usually use a modeling amp and I also use Bias FX 2 software for my recording. So I don't really have too many physical pedals. I mostly use like digital software. It's just easier for me. So I haven't actually like gotten too far into the pedals area of gear stuff myself.
Oh, no.
I think Andy could help with that.
I can definitely help, and I will help by saying don't do it. Because once you start, I mean, having said that, I know that there was a question in the chat earlier about analog versus digital, what your thoughts were, and that's obviously answered it. But for me, and of course, I love digital stuff. I love the convenience. I love the fact that I can just click something, and there's so many good stuff available now that there wasn't even 2 years ago. But for me, plugging into a tube amp with a fuzz pedal gives you something you can't get from digital yet. Saying that I'm a purist, I'm absolutely not, but I'm massively into fuzz and sort of big sludgy deep notes that you just play a couple of bass notes and just feel that feeling. And I would recommend just going to a music shop and trying that, you know, getting some distortion pedals, plugging it into an amp and just playing a few low power chords, especially on the seventh string, just to see how that feels. That's an amazing feeling, and it can really, for me, elevate the guitar playing experience.
Yeah, I just have like the tiny like Yamaha THR-10 practice amp, so I've never really played with like a big sound amp or anything like that. So that would be fun someday. It would probably be like kind of shocking.
The video.
I always keep the volume
the
low.
The video. I play my first 4x12 or whatever. You know.
Yeah.
People would watch the heck out of it.
Not a bad idea.
Yeah, I would watch that. Please send it to me if and when you do it.
Full stack. Did anyone say full stack?
And then your videos will totally change. I bought 7 microphones, 2 cabs, and amp. Yeah, oh man, I would love to see the smile on your face when you experience it. That would be brilliant fun.
Does sound fun now that we're talking about it.
Yeah, but no pressure. Just whatever you're doing is working for you. So, you know, there's no need to change anything. It's as long as it's fun, that's all that matters.
Absolutely.
We've got a few more questions in here. My question was, you mentioned a headless guitar. Is that something you'd like look into, being a metal player? But
yeah, I'm just kind of curious. I do have like Steinberg guitar that I got for like traveling once that has like headlessness, but it's not necessarily like the best guitar. It's kind of heavy, and I think for me, like, what appeals to me about the Strandbergs, potentially, I haven't tried one, is that they're trying to be ergonomic and light and comfortable. So I'm just kind of curious more about that aspect than about the headlessness. Right. I don't really care too much either way about the headlessness, but just curious to try like a new form of guitar, something that's innovating.
I have tried a few Strandbergs, and when I first played it, it was super weird because the neck is kind of half a hexagon. Yeah. But once you get over what you think is correct, then it works. I had a great time, and it was the Telecaster style one. And I didn't have it plugged in, so I can't comment on the actual sound or anything like that. But as a playing experience, it was really, really good. I really enjoyed it.
Yeah, it's very unique. Just the neck looks so strange. But I imagine you just adjust to it over time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I did in the 10 minutes I was allowed to play it.
Yeah,
I didn't want to put it down, put it that way, and it's always a nice thing to pick up. I don't have one though. Maybe that needs to change at some point. I guess some final questions. We've got a few beginners, or not beginners, but new guitar players in the chat sometimes, and they're asking if team player asked if Rachel tried different string gauges and figured out ones you like most, or do you stick to the strings that come with the guitar?
Yeah, so I did. I think the guitars probably came with like 10s to start, but I switched down a gauge. So I used 9s on one guitar and then like 9 through 46 hybrids on the other. So like the kind of hybrid of 9s and 10s. Mm-hmm. I personally like the thinner strings are just more comfortable for me to bend and play with. But yeah, I kind of just stuck with that pretty much. I also tried out, like, I was using Elixirs now as well, with the like slick strings are kind of nice, the coated strings. So yeah, I did experiment a bit, but yeah, I don't know. I like the 9-10 hybrid most, I think.
Yeah. To be fair, with a guitar with tremolo, it's not the most comfiest idea to kind of go back and forth on different string gauges.
Yeah, that one I don't change as much. The one back there, I change right. more often.
All right.
That's a weekend rest. Yeah.
Yeah.
Rachel, I want to say thank you. We're gonna end the chat with a compliment, I guess, and a thing that should definitely inspire everybody else and everybody in the chat. Saying from Dave's Guns and Games is that Rachel inspired me to play guitar again after 10 years. Thanks, Rachel.
That's always so cool to hear. I really appreciate that. And I'm always kind of speechless when people say things like that. So it's just really cool.
Yeah, you're an enabler. So well done. Rachel, I would love to have you back at some point, and especially when you've started your Twitch and done more live streaming as well. And thank you for coming with us and Invisible Dan tonight. Dan, I miss you. So I miss looking at your face.
Some reaction. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, well, thank you so much for having me on. It was really fun.
Good.
Yeah, Andy was super, super excited about it. I think he finished the actual thumbnail for the show like as early as possible. We've never had the whole show set up so early on. That was quite the first. So you can tell that he was completely looking forward to that. Yeah. Again, Rachel, thanks so much for joining us. Like Andy said, whenever you have set up a Twitch account, maybe we just do it and vice versa and visit you on Twitch.
Sounds good. We'll see.
that'll be fun. Apart from that, I mean, just keep on doing what you do. It's so contagious in a positive way, and kind of like Andy just pointed out, kind of passing the torch on to more people and enthusiasm about playing the guitar, and that's the best compliment that you can get. So thanks so much for doing that. Thanks to everyone in the chat, and thanks to everybody out there on the podcatchers for listening to that show. Check out Rachel's Instagram account or her YouTube channel. It's called Rachelf. Wonderful videos there, her first experience with the piano and the progress throughout the last couple of years. Those are videos that will put a big smile on your face. Highly recommended. Andy, any last words? Rachel, any last words?
Rachel?
Yeah, just thanks so much for... This is my first podcast I've been on, so I really appreciate you having me here.
Premiere!
Yeah, awesome. It's really fun.
Oh, welcome. Well, you're welcome back anytime. And when I'm doing Twitch and stuff like that, if you ever pop up, I would love to have you on the show again.
Yeah, sounds great.
I will
great.
Post all your necessary links in the video description to this, and we'll also put it in the podcast descriptions, etc., so people can find you. And yeah, again, much love, and please just keep spreading joy and playing guitar and making cool videos so I can watch when I should be working.
I'll try my cool. best.
thank you. Yeah, thanks to everyone in the chat. Thank you for listening on the audio version on podcast land. Dan will probably ask you to leave us a 5-star review. Is that right, Dan?
That is correct.
So yeah, if you're in the review thing, then don't even think about it. Just click 5 stars. It's much quicker that way, and more efficient. You can get on to the rest of your day. And we'll be back next week with. Oh, I can't tell you what we've got next week. It's a secret. But I will let you know. I'll be making the thumbnail very soon and getting this post. So, yeah, I hope you have good fun. And if you haven't joined the Discord, join the Discord. We can chat on there. That's it, everybody. Thank you, everybody, for watching and listening.
Have a great night, everyone.
Bye-bye.
Bye.